picks of the week. Wahl's out here to make you some money. Are you ready to make some money?
All right, welcome into another edition of Big Wahl's Big Picks of the Week. We are back, as always, midweek here, looking at the college football slate and trying to find picks that we deem, worthy enough to be inside of Nate Wahl's top six that he thinks that is going to make us a steak dinner next weekend. So, all right, without further ado, we're going to bring in Nate. Nate, what's up, brother?
We're doing good, 50, kind of a 50-50 picks on picks last week. So, I mean, 50% is always the number we hope for. So, hoping to get well over 50% this week. Had a little fun with college basketball, but we're in that football mojo. So let's get to it.
Right on. Speaking of getting to it, it's about that time of the season where playoff teams are looking to secure their spot or make their move or get themselves set up. We got some games coming up, you know, very soon. Obviously, you have Michigan and Ohio State. You've got the SEC championship coming up between Georgia and Alabama. A lot of games with top 10 matchups that are going to have huge implications on the playoff picture. But you have gone off the board, off the grid with the top 10 with this week's action with the Big Six. I've got, just to name a couple, we've got the UAB, Texas A&M, and the Colgate Army game. So you're definitely flying under the radar when it comes to your picks of the week.
Yeah, I mean, that was kind of my scope this week. I saw a lot of games that were FBS versus FCS. So, I mean, obviously there's a great slate of games this week, don't get me wrong, but this is kind of the week where your SEC, your dominant SEC teams, they like to, maybe go play someone they can easily kick their rear end in and, just boost their ranking. So, these are kind of my six that I feel were pretty good locks. So, it's just kind of where I'm standing this week. I mean, I think I have some games like the ones on NBC and the ones on, a lot of focus on the Big Ten this week. Actually picked against my my fellow team, so that's kind of where I'm at.
Well, let's go ahead and dive right in and start right there, talking about Wisconsin and Purdue. Wisconsin's had a tough year. It's been injury filled. Jonathan Taylor has been a bright spot, but he cannot do everything. I know a lot of defensive injuries as well. Facing a Purdue team that, there's two stories to their season at this point. You have the opening three-game losing streak to start the season, and then you have, obviously, the big win against Ohio State right there, smack dab in the middle. You got Wisconsin, you got Purdue, obviously. Big matchup in the Big Ten as far as pride at this point. What do you see going on in this spot?
See, I see something that hasn't happened in the last 10 seasons. Wisconsin's been pretty victorious against Purdue. They're 10-0 in their last 10 against Purdue, regardless if they're at home or away. But I see the coin flipping on this one. I think, with Wisconsin's, like you said, Jonathan Taylor can't do it all. I mean, it's a real easy stop, especially when you're going in between Hornibrook and Cohn and, those different quarterbacks that they've used and just haven't had luck with either of them. I mean, you need something that's going to, draw them off to, not think, oh, we're running the ball again. Purdue's kind of figured it out this year as far as, obviously Jeff Brohm took the toughest XFL hit ever and had a decent NFL career. But he definitely has created a passing offense at Purdue. They're in the top 15 in passing in college football, which is not something that they've been really – I don't think they've been known for in their last, 5, 10 years. So he's kind of brought a new swagger to the Boilermakers. And I think, Wisconsin's been a real dismal on the road. I think, this year they've only won 25% of their games on the road. They've had – I don't think they've had a lot of tough games. I mean, Penn State, I knew was going to be tough, but, Northwestern, I think they should have won. There's a lot of games that they should only show on BYU. But I mean, you know, Purdue, I'm leaning with the Boilermakers on this one. It breaks my heart a little bit, but you know, sometimes in the gambling world, you got to do with what's smart and versus what's right, you know.
Yeah, you got to bet with your wallet and not your heart, right?
Exactly. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, most definitely. It's strange to see a year here where Wisconsin is down, especially, like you said, after the last decade plus of Badger football. But here we are, you know, we can't win them all, as they say. And Nate thinks they're not going to win this one. So you got Purdue on the money line at this spot. Let's talk Colgate and Army. That feels like the armed forces versus pearly white teeth. So that's what I always think of when I think of Colgate. You know, the first thought doesn't always come university to my mind. But nevertheless, the total in this one is 37 at this spot. You've got that triple option offense versus I don't even know what in Colgate. I'm not going to begin to even break them down. Colgate and Army at West Point, the total's 37. Which way do you see on this one?
Even though the number's extremely low, I still am taking the under on this. I think with Colgate, you know, they played Syracuse early this season. Syracuse is now a top 13 team. And, you know, they only put up 7 points at the Carrier Dome against Syracuse. So, I mean, to really kind of look at it from that perspective, I mean, they've scored heavily in the Patriot League. But, I mean, Patriot League is a hell of a lot different than playing, you know, a team like Army, who, you know, does have really good defense. And, you know, like you said, that triple option just, you know, kind of wears you down. I do think, you know, Army's never been a team, you know, I'm going to run up the score. I guess I did a little research on these two teams' background. And, I mean, you know, the scores are high from, you know, last time they played was 1997. So, I mean, you can't obviously use those stats for now, but I mean, it's one of those things. I see this on an under. I see a score of, you know, Army wins 24-10 or 27-3 or, you know, something like that. You know, it'll be under the 37, just because, you know, I don't think Colgate is 9-0 this year in the Patriot League, but I mean, when they're going up against a 7-2 Army team, I think Army's playing some of their best football I've seen them play throughout the years. So it should be a good one. I think Army will win victoriously, but I'm taking under 37 on that game.
Yeah, that's definitely, for a college football game, even for NFL standard, that's a pretty low total. Not often you see totals in either league in the 30s, especially with two offenses, you're right, that may not even get there at that point. So, all right, let's press forward. Syracuse and Notre Dame, you like a total in this one. The total is 66. This game will be played on a baseball field at Yankee Stadium, which I know they've done that in the past. Notre Dame has. I believe they may have played Syracuse or Penn State. Another total here, like you said, 66. Probably the best matchup of the week as far as ranked opponents go, because you have 12 versus 3. Another, you know, this game has playoff implications. How do you see this one shaping out? Total 66 again.
So this one is kind of where I'm standing with this. I mean, 66, you know, Notre Dame, you know, they can score when they need to. And, you know, Syracuse can score when they need to. But to see a scenario with this that, you know, the total gets, you know, to a potential, you know, 32-30. Five game. It's just not something I see. I see this kind of more of a defensive battle. I think Syracuse is a great defense as well as Notre Dame. It's just a very tough scenario to see. When Notre Dame, even though Notre Dame's not, I mean, they're a home team, but obviously it's played on a neutral site. I mean, I've heard New York is full of Irish fans. So they will kind of have a home field, you know, mentality at Yankee Stadium. But, you know, when they do play at home or in kind of home stadium, in their home stadium, you know, they go under about 75% of the time. So I think that's a number that I kind of looked at and kind of that jumped out to me. And to kind of see, you know, defensively, you know, averaging throughout the season. You know, both of these teams, you put their defenses together as far as scoring, you know, they're only, it's only about 54 to 55 points a game. And, you know, I don't see this, you know, I don't see this game getting a whole hell of a lot of points. I mean, I think it'll be kind of similar to the last game we talked about, you know, like a 24-10 game or, you know, 27-14, something like that. I think Notre Dame will play tough. I think Syracuse will play tough, but I think in the end, Notre Dame's going to have more juice than Syracuse and win this one. But I'm just playing the under on this one of 66.
Yeah, that's a lot of points to give up. And I know Brian Kelly, as much as he's an offensive innovator, probably prides himself on his team playing defense as well. But that's a bold move, especially with Brian Kelly and Dino Babers, two great offensive minds. But you know what? I think with a total in that range, you know, with two offenses like this, they're begging you to take the over, and the under is probably a smart play in that spot. I always feel more comfortable if my money's on the side of Vegas. At least the side I think Vegas is on. You never quite know. Last total in your Big Six here, UAB and Texas A&M. Like you talked about, this is one of those spots, you know, where the SEC pretty much punts the week as far as competition. You have Alabama playing Citadel, Florida playing Idaho. You have Kentucky playing Middle Tennessee, and you have Texas A&M playing UAB. The total is 45 in this one. Another one seems like a total that Texas A&M could probably achieve by themselves. Nevertheless, how do you sit on this total, 45 points?
This is the one I'm sitting the over on. I mean, with 45, I mean, I've kind of been reading the numbers. UAB is actually a great team. I mean, they're 9-1 this year in Conference USA. They've had a great season. I mean, Texas A&M, you know, has, you know, kind of played Texas A&M. You know, football this year, you know, obviously with Jimbo over there, and Kellen Mond at quarterback, you know, they've had success, but I don't think they're having as much success as they prefer. But I mean, I think this is a game. I mean, 45, I mean, like you kind of said, I mean, for Texas A&M, I mean, you could easily get this total if it's, you know, a 42-7 game or, a 35-14 game. You know, I see the scores kind of looking like that. I think UAB's got a good rushing attack with Spencer Brown. But I also think, you know, Texas A&M, you know, 45, you know, I'm always surprised with the SEC. I know it's very much a defensive conference, but, you know, to see something in the mid-40s just kind of jumped out to me to see that number. I think is pretty low, even though Vegas will think otherwise. It's kind of what I wanted to go with. I think 45 is, you know, from what I've seen from Texas A&M with their previous, you know, points games, you know, I think they can definitely cover it versus, you know, when they play, say, Texas Tech or, you know, teams like that where, you know, you're expecting that it's going to be, you know, 70 points is your total. I think 45 is definitely achievable.
Fair enough. That's good assessment because you're right. Like I said before, Texas A&M could do this by themselves potentially if the offense is clicking and Jimbo and Kellen are on the same page, firing all cylinders. So yeah, 45 is another total that even in college doesn't seem incredibly high. All right, let's move into the spreads that you have. You have two spreads here in your Big Six. Let's first start with Indiana and Michigan traveling to the Big House. Are the Hoosiers getting four touchdowns at this point? Indiana's been able to put it together on offense. They've had some leads late, one against Ohio State. They've been very close and been in games with a lot of the teams on the schedule this season. Michigan is on another level, though. I mean, they lost their first game, and I believe they've rattled off 9 or 10 straight at this point. Obviously, we are on a collision course for Michigan-Ohio State next weekend. Any chance of a look ahead at this point? Like you said, Indiana's getting four touchdowns at this point. What do we see in this matchup?
See, I like Indiana taking the +28, and here's why. Since in the last three games that Indiana's played against Jim Harbaugh, Indiana's covered 66% of the time. And you mentioned those big games that they've played earlier. They're 2-0 against Ohio State and Penn State, which are number 10 and number 14 ranked, respectively, this year. And, you know, they covered – obviously, Ohio State was a very close game, and Penn State, you know, wasn't as close. But, I mean, at the same time, I mean, to cover against teams like that, it makes me have hope that, you know, with such a high number at, you know, 4 touchdowns, if they have the true grit to actually do that against Michigan. Now, obviously, it is that in Ann Arbor, so that could be a deciding factor. But I still really like Indiana in this game. They haven't had a great year. They've had a mediocre loss against Minnesota. They barely beat Rutgers. I mean, they're kind of all over the grid. It really depends which team shows up. Is it a team that almost beat Ohio State, or is it a team that beat Rutgers by 7 and lost to Minnesota? I mean, it really depends. And just as an FYI, I would just love this to rub in Jim Harbaugh's face, because Jim Harbaugh said earlier this season that he does not like sports gambling. So just to kind of kick Harbaugh in the rear end, if Indiana can cover the spread, that'd make me real happy. And that's kind of where I'm at, you know, against, you know, just the fact that he said, you know, I don't like sports gambling, sports betting, none of that, you know, kind of, you know, feeding against the people that, you know, cheer for you. But that's another topic. We won't talk about that.
Well, in fairness, the other dribble that came out of Harbaugh's mouth was that he doesn't trust anybody who eats chicken because it's a nervous bird. So, I mean, he's kind of a walking soundboard at this point as far as
truly, he is.
What's going to come out of his gullet next. But, yeah, I mean, you can process this one of two ways at this point with the plus 28. You can see it as a look-ahead game for Michigan, or you can see it as the fact that Indiana gets up for the games like this, like you talk about Ohio State. Duke and Clemson's another similar one. Duke's getting 4 touchdowns plus a hook, 28.5. Looking at Clemson's schedule, you know, they have their rivalry game with South Carolina, and then what seems more than likely that they'll play either Pittsburgh or Virginia, probably Pittsburgh at this point because they hold the tiebreaker. Clemson's starting to get, you know, kind of, I mean, they won't tell you this, but they're starting to get mentally prepared for the playoff at this point. I mean, this is a spot where I feel like Duke's a better team offensively than people give them credit for. And because they're not Clemson, and because, you know, the ACC is all things considered down this year, which, I mean, I wouldn't consider that. I mean, the reason they say that is because of Florida State and Miami being and Virginia Tech being poor, but I would say, you know, I would say the ACC overall has just, you know, the bottom teams traditionally have stepped up and played some pretty decent football in Syracuse and Boston College. Nevertheless, Duke's also one of those teams playing good football the last few years at 7-3, getting 28.5 in this spot against a team who, like I said, was preparing at this point in the early stages for the CFP semifinals.
Yeah, and I mean that I'm kind of taking the Duke on this one as far as the plus 28.5. When I've looked at Duke spreads this year, I've never seen Duke such a dog, really. I mean, they've a lot of their numbers, they're either, you know, a favorite or they're just barely a dog by, you know, 3, maybe 5. I think I saw the highest was 6 or 7. But to see them as 28.5, it jumped out to me because I don't think Duke is, you know, like you said, you know, they're not a great offensive team, but, you know, they do enough to get the job done. And I do think, you know, defensively, you know, they're in the top 50. I mean, Clemson obviously is a great defense in itself, but I do think Duke, you know, all in all can hold this 28.5. I don't think it's unreachable. Clemson also against the spread at home in their last 6 is just 33%. So, I mean, that's a number that jumped out to me. You know, Clemson obviously, you know, obviously Death Valley, you have home field advantage obviously when you win, of course, but against the spread, it's kind of speaking a different language to me. But I mean, as far as Duke, you know, they have struggled against Clemson. That's the biggest kicker. You know, you can look at their against the spread numbers in the last six games, but when you look at their against spread numbers against Duke, against Clemson, it's not the greatest. But I mean, I just 20.5 just seemed way too high to me. That's kind of where I stood with it.
Yeah, most definitely. And all of a sudden, or not all of a sudden, but obviously. Clemson's coming off that game against Boston College where, despite the score, they were in a little bit of a dogfight as well. So between last week and the look ahead forward, you know, this may be a prime spot to take an underdog of 4 touchdowns in the Dukies. So good lay right there in that spot, in my opinion. All right, let's recap Nate Wahl's big picks of the week. We've got the Colgate and Army. We've got the Fighting Black Knights versus the Fighting Future Dentists at under 37. Syracuse and Notre Dame believes to stay under the total of 66. Unfortunately for the Wisconsin Badger fans, they are going to finally lose a game against Purdue in Nate's eyes. He's taking the money line currently at minus 200. Indiana and Michigan, he's taking the points with Indiana. 4 touchdowns, 28 points right there in that spot. Texas A&M hosting UAB. He's going to take the over 45. And he's going to take Duke plus 28.5 against the Tigers of Clemson. Any other games you're looking forward to watching this week that aren't on your slate of big picks?
I mean, really, the Ole Miss Vanderbilt game is, in my opinion, I mean, it's kind of what I think one of the best, maybe one of the better SEC games of the week. There's just not a lot, like we kind of said, you know, there's a lot of, you know, back and forth as far as, you know, who the SEC, they're, like you said, they're dropping back and punting this week versus, you know, playing an outstanding opponent or, you know, it's just the way the SEC operates. And I just realized, you know, Georgia's playing UMass. That's another one that you're kind of like, okay, you're going to crush them. But, I mean, all in all, I mean, I do think, you know, with that game, I do think, you know, Vanderbilt could jump Ole Miss. And Ole Miss, I thought was going to have a good year, but they just haven't operated quite as well as I thought they would. But I think that'll be a good game. Yeah, they definitely have. But that's one game I'm looking at this weekend.
Right on, right on. And I will pull a shameless plug and hope that everybody listening out there tunes into, in my opinion, the game of the week, and that's Cincinnati traveling down to Orlando for to face UCF, hopefully building UCF's playoff resume by a large defeat by the Knights. College game day will be there, Derp Herb Street and friends. Hopefully we'll give a little love to UCF. So shameless plug, but I felt like it was necessary. So.
Yeah, it's the right time for, especially with game day being in town.
Yeah. So, all right, well, Nate, hopefully another slate here of picks can make us a steak dinner this weekend. We maybe can take our winnings over to Dave and Buster's and play some video games.
That would be good. They're opening one here next year, so I can do it next year.
There you go. You can hold on to that and maybe put it in the bank and gain some interest before you go.
There you go.
All right.
A little extra money.
All right. That is Nate Wahl, lead college football writer for 12-Ounce Sports, giving you, as he does every week, his big Wahl's big picks of the week, his big six-pack. I'll go over them one more time before we sign off. Under 37 in the Colgate and Army, under 66 in the Syracuse-Notre Dame, Purdue money line against Wisconsin, Indiana plus 28 at Michigan, over 45 in the Texas A&M UAB, and Duke plus 28.5 on the road versus Clemson. Nate, as always, we appreciate it, my friend, and we will talk next week.
All right, we'll see you.